Hello, I'm John McGrath. I'm a producer for Flatland at Kansas City PBS, and I'm here to tell you about the HBO documentary shot right here in Kansas City called Transhood, directed by Sharon Liese.
Okay, tell me about what you felt like when you first started doing the documentary.
I started off not really knowing who I was, because, I mean, I was a kid, and I'm 12 now. Here we go!
Transhood is a documentary in which I follow four kids in Kansas City for 5 years who are transgender or gender fluid. And when I started the documentary, the kids were 4, 7, 12, and 15. And at the end of the documentary, they're 5 years older. So, you know, what I think is really unique about the film is this panoramic view that you get of these kids and their families' lives. So it was really, really an honor and a privilege to tell these stories.
My family really doesn't talk to me. My mother thinks I'm a child abuser.
Jay was able to get his birth certificate changed to male.
They changed it!
Jay, I want to talk to you. Okay, so what do you hope this film does for young people that are going through what you went through? What do you hope that this film does for that?
I hope that like this film really shows awareness, because there is a lot of issues with people not understanding, you know, what transgender is and what people actually go through. So I really hope this helps our community as becoming, you know, the next generation, that it just shows that we're just the same as everybody else, and people don't see us any differently. I mean, I really hope that it helps kids that are scared to come out. I hope that people, if they don't know how to talk to their parents, that it helps them, you know, create that conversation in their household, you know, let their parents know, this is who I am. This is, you know, I'm not any different, but this is who I want to be, and this is how I want to express myself. And I think it's really important that little kids understand that it's okay and they can be who they want to be.
There's a little bit of, are you nervous about people seeing the film, or how do you feel about this when this comes out on HBO?
I'm really excited. I'm super excited. I've actually talked to some of my closest friends recently, telling them, hey, this is what's going on. I'm going to be everywhere, you know, and I told them that, you know, if you don't feel comfortable, I can't be mad at you. I can't like bash your name. I can't hold a grudge, because, you know, it's a lot for someone to take in. It's a lot for someone to really realize, oh, wow, like they're going to be everywhere, you know, and it's nerve-wracking, but I'm really excited, because I think this will be a good thing, and I think once people see it, it will put a good word out there for everybody, and it will be a good conversation that everybody talks about.
What is Mario? I think he's a plumber. But the main question is, what gender is Yoshi? No one knows the answer to that question, and no one ever will.
When we started with Avery and her transition, we didn't feel like there was anywhere to turn. We didn't know who to talk to or where to go, and we felt desperately lost.
Okay, let's talk about Avery and Debi. Debi, you're a parent going through this. So, Debi, a lot of it is like the cover of National Geographic. Tell me a little bit about that and any regrets, or because after that, when she wanted to kind of pull away and just be a kid again, I love the conversation that you and your husband had, that, you know, as activists, we will still move on. So tell me about the National Geographic's cover, and then how your activism still goes on, even though she just still wants to be a kid.
Sure. We were very excited to have her participate in National Geographic. They did a story. She was part of a story about nine-year-olds, and they photographed 80 of them and were going to choose nine. So the odds of her even being part of the story were really low. And I guess what she said, some of her quotes just blew them away so much that they decided this is the cover and this is the story we want to tell. So we were just as surprised as everyone else. When she first saw the magazine, I was like, oh my gosh, this is your cover. And she said, it's not my cover, it's our cover. This is for every trans person out there. And that's always how she's approach things. She doesn't really want a lot of attention on her. She loved that we were able to help get the transgender house next door to the Equality House in Topeka. It's something that other people can see and take inspiration from. So yeah, there was a lot of negativity. The timing of the National Geographic coming out was not in our favor, and a lot of hatred and anger was, and anti-trans sentiments were allowed to resurface in society around that time. So that was one of the things that she just said, I don't, you know, people were saying, you're going to be the new face of the movement. And she said, I don't want to be the face of anything. So thank you, but no, I'll pass. Again, you just never know with kids how they're going to react to things. We've asked her multiple times if we should all back off. And she said, no, you're out there doing good things. I just don't want to have to be the person that everyone looks to. I just want to be a kid. And I really think, like, National Geographic, I still get messages from people saying, I use that to come out to my parents or my spouse. Or if I can see a 9-year-old speaking so confidently, why am I afraid to come out at 65? I'm going to do that. And I think Transhood is going to do the same thing. You see so much courage in these kids and the resiliency and the conversations happening that it's going to be more than just kids that get inspired. I think it's going to be a lot of other people who decide, you know, if they can do that in this environment and the challenges they've gone through, I can too.
Wow. Yeah. Just the courage. That's what I've got when I watched the film, just the courage of the kids, the young adults too, and the parents. So Jay, here's an interesting thing I want to ask you about. Haircuts. That was kind of a cool thing. It seemed like it was cathartic, and it was a way for you to express who you really were and how your barber was kind of became a good friend with you. I know it sounds kind of trivial to some people, but tell people how getting your hair cut the way that you wanted to and sitting down and doing that. Was it just me watching the film, or is that kind of something that was a kind of a big to you in the starting of this?
So getting my haircut was a really big part of, it was more, I think of my hair of kind of like my mask. So, you know, my hair really kind of makes me feel like me. And actually, funny story, my, Nana, she took me to get my first haircut, to cut my hair really short when I was right before the film. I think like a year before the film, I had really long hair and I cut it to like my chin, my jawline. And it was, my mom freaked out. Well, then my mom was like, oh no, we got to go get this fixed. So then we saw Jaren and we cut my hair super short. And my mom was just, she loved it. And she was like, this is what you've been wanting. I see the light now. And it's just ever since then, I've gotten my hair cut. It was just like weight lifted off my shoulder every time I got a haircut. And I just loved it because I could talk to my barber about it. I could, about everything, you know. He would always ask me like what's going on in life. Like it was amazing. And I just still love getting my haircut. I think it's just one big thing in my life that definitely helped me.
Yeah, Debi, what do you think about as a parent? Isn't that, am I kind of on the same wavelength even with Avery with her hair and just the way she dresses? Tell people about that, how at the beginning that's kind of a huge thing.
Yeah, I'm always jealous of trans guys because they can go from long hair to short in an instant. And like you said, the light comes on. Trans girls often have a little bit more of a challenge. So Avery, we had always just used clippers and given our kids pretty much buzz cuts. And she had to start growing her hair out from that. So to support her, I had somewhat short hair already, but I went and got my hair cut into a really, really short pixie as well. And that way, when we were out together, it was just, oh, you know, little girl who wanted to have hair like her mom. And we got little stick-on gems that she could use as earrings and stuff, just doing anything to kind of feminize her for other people. But then a lot of kids, when they first transition, really go to extremes, at least younger ones. So for trans girls, it's all the pink, it's all the sparkles, it's the tutu skirts, it's as over the top feminine as they can get. And a lot of really, really young trans boys will start wearing little button down shirts and bow ties and other things that they see men wear. And that's how they, you know, show the world, this is who I am. And then generally after a little while, when they've been affirmed and are feeling more confident in themselves, a lot of them kind of throw all of the rules away and just decide, now I'm just going to be comfortable in whatever I'm going to feel best in, and add more colors back into my wardrobe and that kind of thing. But yeah, it's always really fascinating to see the gender presentation that they've learned from society. They feel like they have to emulate in order to be, you know, seen as who they are by others.
One thing that I really loved and we're so proud about here at Kansas City PBS and on Art House is this was done right here in Kansas City. Tell people about telling stories in the Midwest and how this brings out, you know, the greatness of these great people that are are doing this here in Kansas City.
Yeah, it's funny now because people have always asked me like, oh, are you in New York or are you in L.A.? And I'll say, no, I'm right in the middle of the country. I'm in Kansas City. And they're like, wow, how do you tell stories from the Midwest? Well, what's interesting about the pandemic is that people are now living and working the way I always have, you know, because you can do whatever you need to do right from your, you know, right from where you are with a computer and a phone, at least pre-production wise. So, you know, for me, I do have to travel a lot for my work, but it's always a treat when I can find a story right here in Kansas City to tell. And there really are lots of stories to tell in Kansas City. And people need to know about what's going on right in the middle of the country, because not everything happens on the coast and not everything that's relatable happens on the coast. And there's a lot of really talented filmmakers in Kansas City. I mean, I think people are really surprised to know the caliber that is here. I mean, just for me, my, you know, Sam Hake is a co-producer, and Ty Jones, who's a well-known cinematographer, is our DP, and Jeremy Osborne also did some filming, and Morgan Cooper and Travis Weirs all have contributed to this film in some way. So, you know, I never had to look outside of Kansas City in terms of for crew. And there's lots to show here. I mean, we even have Children's Mercy Hospital and their pathways, gender pathway services. So, you know, people can make a career in filmmaking in Kansas City for sure.
No, they can. That's so great. Just a couple more. Hey, Jay, when I watched the film, you were not happy. Like, it was weird. You'd go to the doctor's office and you were just strong all the time and your mom's crying. And then we go to a doctor's office and you're strong and your mom's bawling. You know, it was so great to see just how strong you are. But I love the vulnerability that you weren't real happy with your mom about how she had you come out to your girlfriend at the time. And that showed some real vulnerability. And that's what I meant about the courage of doing a documentary like this. That scene was so powerful, Jay.
What's going on? Somebody has pictures of your book. Somebody knows.
This is not a pleasant time to be out and visibly trans.
I felt so much empathy for you there. Because I was going to ask you the broad question, what was the hardest part about this? Was that one of them? And what was it during this journey, during the making of the film? What was one of the hardest parts?
That definitely was one of the hardest parts. Yeah, I would say at that moment in time, I was really mad at my mom because, you know, one, she didn't know what she was kind of doing. She was kind of just trying to protect her kid. She was like, you know, I don't want anything to go out of hand. I don't want anything to go south. So she did it out of love and everything. But like at the time, I didn't know better. So I was just really angry. And I was just like, you know, it was wrong. But now that I've watched the documentary and I've rewatched that scene plenty of times, she did right, and I was just angry and being a kid. But I would definitely say that was one of the hardest parts. Yeah,
Debi, as a parent, what about it for you?
I never thought that I would be an advocate for the LGBT community. I was raised as a Southern Baptist.
You're now going forward with activism and letting your, you know, daughter be a kid. What do you hope this film helps with the activism part, and what are you going to keep doing?
Thank you for that question. Before I hopped on with you, I was on with some folks in Texas, and we were looking at pre-filed bills and the ones that are targeting trans kids for medical care. They were filed the very first day. And that's what I do. I work with other organizations and community members to get parents in the right frame of mind to be able to go and talk to legislators and educate them and fight back against the harmful bills that are coming out of the woodwork all across the country. For me, I think this film should be shown to every single legislator out there.
We lost most of our friends and some of our family. We basically went into hiding for about a year while my daughter grew out her hair to look like the girl that she is.
Because there is so much misinformation and they're running wild with it, you know, saying 4-year-olds are getting hormones and 7-year-olds are having surgeries. And the beauty of Transhood is that it very clearly shows what is a social transition. You go to the doctor before puberty just to get educated and to be watching. And it's only after puberty when kids are older and they've been working with therapists and other things that you start a medical transition. So I think this will be really helpful in dispelling a lot of the bad information that's out there, and hopefully we'll convince a few people to watch it. And I don't know how long HBO is going to have it running, but if there's a way that we can get some free passes just for legislators in some states, that would be super helpful, HBO. But I mean, I think that's the big part of it for me is I know that families benefit, and I will always try to work with families directly to help them understand their kids and support their kids. But I'm full on big picture. I want to get out there and just tell every single person in power, leave our kids alone and let them be who they are and stop, you know, judging people that you don't know anything about.
Once that went viral, Avery decided that she could tell her story better than I could and asked if we could make a video of her telling her own story.
Hi, I'm Avery and welcome to Avery Chat. Woo!
So Sharon, HBO, this is showing on HBO. So what's the future for the film? Does it stop here? So give me what's going on with Transhood as a film going forward?
Well, yeah, it's really, HBO has been a wonderful partner, a great home for this film for a long time, I hope. But we do plan to have special screenings because the corporate social responsibility team at HBO is very active in trying to make sure that this film can make a difference. So I know they have a resource page at HBO for trans kids and their families. There's also going to be like a culture spotlight to give context to the themes in the film that will air right after the film for 5 minutes. They're also going to do a translation summit. I believe it's going to be next week, which will be a 3-day event with lots of high profile people. Even some of the people that you see here will be involved. So there's a lot of activity around the film to support it and support the messages and support the themes. So that's really rewarding.
Hey Jay, what's the future for you, buddy? What are you gonna do? And what's your dreams and aspirations? And tell me a bit about what's gonna go on in Jay's future. Cause I know it's gonna be big, my friend.
So I'm actually going to college right now. I'm getting my gen eds out of the way, but I do want to attend KU University within the next year or so. I'm going to go as pre-med, I think, to be an anesthesiologist, either that or a plastic surgeon. But I've got another thing in mind also, so I'm kind of in the mix of choosing. I thought about graphic design because I love to draw and kind of do like building stuff and stuff. So I'm kind of in the mix.
Jay, you got plenty of time, my friend. It'll change 10 times. That's fine. Your parents will be good as long as you're happy. And that's what I want to know. Does this film, what do you want this film to do for other ones that don't want to come out and are scared? And what do you want to say directly to kids, young adults right now that are going through that maybe haven't told anybody? What do you want to tell them?
Well, good news. This documentary is my coming out story. Actually, I've been hiding for 18 years, high school, middle school, elementary school. I have been hiding. The only people that really know is family and like two of my close friends. So this is my coming out. So I definitely want to say, keep your head up. It gets better. Love yourself. It's very important. I have figured out how to love myself and love who I am and embrace it. And it takes time. It is definitely the hardest thing. It's the hardest thing to get over. And there's so many hurdles, but take your time. Don't rush it, because I took my time and I'm in a place now where it's unbelievable. I'm excited. I'm happy. I love myself and I'm ready. I hope that everybody that sees the documentary, find yourself, love yourself, and that's when you know you're ready to tell people. But until then, you know, go at your own pace. If you feel like hiding and hiding is what you got to do, do that, because there, you know, I hid for so long and look at me now. I'm where I wanted to be. It took me a long time and it took a lot of breakdowns and crying and, you know, going through things, but I'm unbelievably happy with myself now. So definitely just take your time.
Oh, Jay, man, you are one amazing young man.
Thank you.
You are. That's so great. And Debi, for parents, you know, it's of parents of kids that are going through this, what do you want to tell them?
First, I just want to say I hate COVID because I want to hug Jay so much right now. I'm so proud of you, Jay. I think it's important for parents to realize what some of my social worker and therapist friends explain very well, that there's a coming in process before there's a coming out process. So I think Jay just explained that pretty well too. It's learning to love yourself. It's figuring things out on the inside before you can really come out and tell other people, this is who I am, and do it with so much confidence and love for yourself that you can handle whatever comes your way after that. For a lot of parents, sometimes they think this is a surprise. It's a surprise to them. They didn't see the signs, or there were signs and then they forgot about those signs and just brushed them off. Your kids have been thinking about it and they've been processing and learning language, or at least trying to understand, why do I have these feelings? How do I tell people? That coming in process can take a really long time, and it shows a lot of courage and a lot of trust if they tell you. So, you know, take a breather. They've been thinking about it for a while. Even if it's brand new to you, it's going to take time to adjust. We don't have to rush anything, but also understand your kid's ready. That's why they've told you. So you need to do what you can to support them. It can be scary and overwhelming at first, but how amazing that you have a child who really can spend that much time looking inward. I mean, I know 50-year-olds who still need to do it. And when you can have a kid or a teenager who's done that much self-work already, you should be really proud and impressed, and support them as much as they deserve.
Yeah, you know, Debi, Avery, at the end of the film, her, you know, what she said was so amazing. You should feel so proud of her. Just to all these kids, you know, Jay. So Sharon, how proud you must be to be able to have captured these amazing people's story.
Yeah, I mean, it's been such a journey with the kids and the families over 5 years. Now it's 6 years because we have the process of kind of putting the film out there in the world. And that's a whole new step and a new time for me to be even more proud and excited for this film and for the lives that these kids are leading and the families. You know, it's, everything's an evolution, and you know, seeing them handle the film coming out and launching it into the world, that also has been an amazing process. So I'm excited for the film. I'm excited for people to see it. I'm excited for it to inspire empathy and greater understanding, and potentially a call to action, and to continue to watch these kids and their families.
What I really hope is that people realize we're human. We're not like some exotic species. We have human emotions. That's what matters.